And to the analysis of Shields and Brooks, that is syndicated columnist Mark Shields and New York Times columnist David Brooks. Welcome, gentlemen.
Judy.
So we just heard the professor say, Mark, whoever wins Ohio is going to win the election. Is that how you see it?
I never argue with a tenured professor. No, I think he's absolutely right.
Okay. What do you think, David?
I often argue with tenured professors, but this one happens to have stumbled upon the truth. I do think it's very hard to see Mitt Romney winning. Without Ohio. It's possible to see Obama winning, but Romney really has to win. And the paradox of the election, one of them is if Barack Obama does win, he should give Steve Rattner, who successfully ran the auto bailout, some sort of high-level government job or some at least a big case of wine to thank him. And the second real irony is that if Mitt Romney wanted to carry Ohio, he should have given a lot of money to the environmental groups who were trying to stop fracking. But the fact that they were unable to stop fracking means that the job growth, especially in eastern Ohio, has been pretty sensational. Not only the energy products itself, but because of the cheap energy it's generating, you're beginning to see fertilizer plants and other things like that. So you're getting some pretty broad prosperity out of that and more to come, and that's as a result of the shale gas.
Mark, you know that state well. Does one candidate or the other have more going for him?
Well, Judy, I mean, this is the year, truly. You can forget the Big Apple and forget Big D in L.A. It's Chillicothe, Zanesville, Steubenville. This is the big casino of this election. I don't see how either one of them wins without Ohio. I'll be very blunt about it. I think that what is interesting about Ohio is it's whiter and older than the country. And that's been the Republican growth area. Has been among more white and older voters. And so it's sort of counterintuitive. Ohio has 1/6 the percentage of Latinos or Hispanic voters that the country does at large. I mean, it doesn't have the minorities that you associate with sort of democratic growth or the democratic coalition. And I really do think David's right. Steve Rattner did a great job, but it was Barack Obama and Mitt Romney was wrong. And they're still on the defensive about this. As recently as Thursday night in Defiance, Ohio, Rob Portman, the senator from Ohio and the surrogate debate substitute for President Obama, introduced Mitt Romney saying, let's get this straight. Mitt Romney was the first guy. Barack Obama took GM and Chrysler through bankruptcy. Mitt Romney was for guaranteeing loans. I mean, they're still trying to explain it, and he's very much on the defensive. So Obama is running better with whites and white males in Ohio than he is elsewhere, in large part because of the auto bailout. And they've got a great on-ground game in Ohio, too.
Yeah. We should emphasize it's not a slam dunk for Obama. If you look at the polls, it's been a very steady two-point advantage in the state for Obama. And one of the oddities of the race so far is that the national numbers, probably a slight Romney favorite right now, the state numbers like Ohio, an Obama favorite. And I don't know too many experienced political hands who expect that to continue, that you get a disjunction between the national numbers and some of these swing state numbers. Usually they come together. It's possible that if Romney gets a plurality or a majority of 50.6, it's possible to see him losing the Electoral College. If he's up over 51 or 52, it's hard to reconcile a 2 or 3 point win with an electoral loss. The numbers have got to be pretty close.
That the two are more likely to go in tandem is what you're saying.
Yeah, I mean it's a crazy system, and David and I can have that debate. I mean, this Electoral College is indefensible.
We can talk about that next.
In the off season. But let's understand this: there is a Republican advantage in Ohio. Ohio is more Republican than the nation, and internally. There's one Democratic statewide office holder, Democratic Senator Sherrod Brown. All the other offices are held by Republicans. The Republicans have strong majorities in both houses of the state legislature, and the congressional delegation is 12 to 4. That's where the lines are drawn, 12 to 4. It may end up 11 to 5 because Betty Sutton may win a district where she's running against Jim Renacci. But that's, it's a 12-4. So it's a Republican state going in. The irony is for Mitt Romney is that John Kasich, whom you saw in the piece, the governor. is extolling all these good news that we just heard. And the Romney people don't want to hear that because part of their message is we've got the economic key and it can't have already happened in Ohio under Barack Obama's watch.
Well, let's broaden it out. You said that you were talking to David about the difference between Ohio and the rest of the country. What does it look like across the country right now in this campaign?
You know, I've read so many very confident people over the last 24 hours, totally confident that Obama's going to win or totally confident that Romney's going to win. I don't think we can know. I think something's going to happen in the last 3 days. There'll be a shift and something will happen. I do think there's been a contrast in how the campaigns are operating in the last couple weeks. And Romney's trying to go big with big change. Paul Ryan gave, I think, quite a good speech on social mobility and poverty earlier in the week. Romney gave what was billed as a major speech on the economy. I'm not sure how new it was, but they're trying to go big and talk about big issues. The Obama campaign, I think, is going small and going even deeper into micro-targeting. They've got this Lena Dunham video targeted to single women. They've got a series of more tightly targeted. They're doing the binders. They're still doing the binders for women, so much more negative stuff. So I personally, I don't know if it'll be effective. Personally, I like the way the Romney campaign has tried to go a little more substantive, while the Obama campaign is still, I think, overwhelmingly negative.
I just come back to the Walter Mondale race with Gary Hart. Where's the beef? I mean, I've heard Romney talk about big change, big change, big change. I didn't know his large bills, but I didn't know his big change. I mean, it's just an adjective and a noun. As far as Paul Ryan's speech on poverty, I mean, Paul Ryan's budget, 62% of the cuts in his budget came from programs for poor people on income maintenance. I think it's wonderful to talk about social mobility. I think it's great to talk about community. But I mean, when the rubber hits the road, who's going to pay for it? I mean, who's going to pay the cost? I mean, there wasn't a single bit of burden imposed by Paul Ryan and his budget on those, the luckiest, the most advantaged, the most privileged of all of us in this country. So, I mean, yes, you can say he's taking on entitlements or whatever else, but, you know, let's not talk about poverty when, in fact, we're cutting the rungs out from those at the very bottom.
Wait, so you're saying they're walking away from what
I just,
they were.
Listen, the Obama campaign has been silent on the subject of poverty. I mean, middle class is their mantra. And I think David's point about their single issue is absolutely true. I think they've been one-dimensional in their approach to women. It's been all about reproductive rights. They haven't talked about the issues of equal pay. They haven't talked about our daughters' rights, I mean, who might be flying a helicopter in Afghanistan or be a special education teacher.
Why do you think they're doing that?
I think they're very much in the segmentation of the electorate. They were going to assemble a majority this way, and if it wins, then I guess it's a successful strategy. But the problem it is, Judy, when you do win, what have you won? I don't think either of these campaigns has been constructed that they do win, they're going to have any kind of a mandate they can point to.
I agree with some of Mark's criticism of the Paul Ryan speech, but at least it was sort of a substantive speech. I mean, I went back, I said, am I imagining the way old campaigns used to be? I went back and looked at some of the 1980 speeches and the debates, Jimmy Carter versus Ronald Reagan. They actually were talking about the major issues of the day, the Soviet Union and inflation and stagflation. If you think of the major issues of the day, well, widening inequality, well, that has not really been talked about. Mm-hmm. Wage stagnation, that's barely been talked about. Global warming, you could go down the list of the big issues of the day. And this campaign, I think more even than real life campaigns, not imagining some Platonic campaign, even more than recent campaigns, has ignored a lot of those issues.
Why do you think that is?
Because the consultants have taken over. And I think both of the candidates are not particularly sincere, especially Mitt Romney. And so they're not running on things that sort of motivate you to get into public life. Yeah. They've decided they've got strategies of how to do it, and the candidates are play-acting out those strategies.
I challenge either one of them to tell President Obama doesn't have grandchildren, but tell his daughters what he's proud about in this campaign. I mean, or to Mitt Romney, that huge, handsome, wonderful family of his, and say, this is what Grandpa stood for in 2012. Judy, you win. I mean, whatever you say about Ronald Reagan, and I said a lot, but I mean, he ran on doubling defense budget, cut taxes by a third. You know, so when he won in 1980, there was a mandate to do it. And I don't see any mandate coming out of this election, unless I'm missing.
And even You know, one of the things that offended me this week is Obama running an ad, I think in Ohio, that ends with Mitt Romney, he's not one of us.
Yeah, that was.
And that's code. That's an old code language. And, you know, you just, as a sense of principle, you just don't run that ad with that sort of slogan. And so it's, again, part of the dispiriting part of the race.
And we saw the debate on Monday night. I mean, we saw the old Mitt who said, Iraq war, I was for it, I support it then, I support it now. What's he say on Monday night? We don't want another Iraq. I'm not Dick Cheney, I'm not George W. Bush. I mean, peace. I mean, the new Mitt, I mean, we'd had the new Nixon in 68. I mean, the new improved Mitt, he did the same thing on Iran sanctions. He was talking about an aerial strike. He was talking about an invasion or an attack upon Iran as recently as months ago. And now we say, no, I'm all for sanctions. We have to do it peacefully and diplomatically. So, I mean, who is this man? Who are, you know, that's
a good... And I feel like we're coming to the end of this campaign with the two large questions unanswered, crucial questions. Would Mitt Romney buck the Republican Party at any time if he were elected president? And secondly, does Barack Obama have sort of a second wind, a second burst of policy creativity?
Well, he did put out this 20-page
but that was a rehash
of
small
of his,
things that, frankly, if you go to his book that he wrote in 2007, I bet most of those things are in that 2007 book. And so they're fine. They're, you know, community colleges, more math and science teachers than for all that kind of stuff. But it's not exactly a huge agenda. And so you're a voter, you're trying to imagine what's the next 4 years going to look like. I think it's very hard because those big questions have been unanswered.
Well, it's only 10 days to go after this, and I was going to ask you about the ground game and all kinds of other things, but this has been better than that. Better than the ground game.
It's important for us to vent emotionally.
We can talk about that.
It's good for us to get in touch with our feelings.
Mark Shields, David Brooks, thank you both.
Thank you.
And there's more politics talk with Mark, David, and Hari on the doubleheader recorded in our newsroom. That's going to be posted at the top of the rundown later tonight.